got it now. So with my background, I thought this would be a nice way to put across the present situation about antimicrobial resistance and the antimicrobial stewardship that we are undertaking in this hospital. In fact, explaining about the stewardship in the hospital is only a part of the story. The rest of the story is going to be how you're going to handle your OPD patients, patients who come to you in your clinic, how to avoid using antibiotics. Because as we all know, what is stewardship? Stewardship is right patient, right dose, right duration of the antibiotic, right? So in case we have, I'll just quote an example. In case we have an issue with sugar, we say, theek hai, endocrinologist ko dikha do. We have an issue with ECG, we say, chalo, theek hai, usko, cardiologist ko dikha do. But antibiotic, everybody is willing to give. There, nobody wants to ask because it is something which they say is out of my experience. I have been given antibiotics for so many years. But that is what has exactly created the problem. And our goal right now for the stewardship is to enhance patient health outcomes, reducing the resistance to antibiotics, and after all, decrease unnecessary costs which are associated with antibiotic therapy. So antimicrobial resistance, as we all know, is a growing threat, unavoidable. A World Health Organization has commented that it is an increasingly serious threat to global public health that requires action across all government sectors and society. So that is where probably we all come in. Lancet had commented long time back that resistance to last resort antibiotics has led to an epidemic of hard to treat infections such as MRSA, ESBL producing Enterobacteriaceae, carbapenem resistant Enterobacteriaceae, NDM1 as we all know, and resistant gonorrheal infections in the world. And this is Dr. Ghafoor from Apollo Hospitals, Chennai, who has also commented about that if you are not careful, we will end up in a post-antibiotic era, and for some patients we are already there. We do get patients in the hospital who are, you know, infected with multi-drug resistant organisms. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention has also predicted that yes, there is going to be a post-antibiotic era soon if we do not control the use of antibiotics. And why has this happened? Because of spread of certain resistant clones all over the world. Like for example, penicillin resistant pneumococci started from Europe and has now spread all across the world. We have had MRSA, almost about 75% of isolates, especially you can see those countries, our neighboring country there. That is about 75% resistance of MRSA isolate, or rather staphylococcus isolates to methicillin. USA is around 5%, you can say. India somewhere in between, it is in the gray zone, around 25%. So we are still yet to catch up. Now E. coli, the first thing I would like to point out here is E. coli in the society itself has developed, or rather in the community itself has developed resistance to fluoroquinolones. That is due to the rampant use. For any gastroenteritis or any other fever, we tend to give fluoroquinolones. So this organism has picked up resistance, it's no longer effective. And as far as third generation cephalosporins are concerned, again many isolates happen to be resistant to third generation cephalosporins also. Klebsiella pneumoniae is the problem organism. It has created a lot of resistance to the carbapenems, which are almost the last resort antibiotics, as we already know, meropenem, imipenem category. There also we find about 60 to 70% isolates are already resistant to carbapenems, and India is a big contributor to this in the form of NDM, or the New Delhi metallobetalactamase, which is a enzyme which degrades all cephalosporins starting from carbapenems. So why does this resistance occur? Have we ever thought about it? Why does it occur? One is the enormous biomass of microorganisms. How old would be the Earth, just as a guess, geographical terms or maybe geological terms? Let's say about 3 billion years. How long have we been there as human beings? Ek ghadi mein agar ek ghanta hai, toh hum last 12 second mein hai. But these bacteria have been there for the full hour. So they are there before us. We are actually in their world. And our gut is full of these organisms. If we have 1 billion cells, we have 3 billion organisms in our gut. So we are actually competing with them. It is their survival. So the more you throw antibiotics at them, they will get more resistant. and inki khasiyat ye hai, their division rate makes mutations in their genome a natural phenomenon. So some mutations may automatically code for resistance to antibiotics. So if you keep giving antibiotics, it will select those mutations, select those clones with which have those mutations. Dusra kya hai, they have something called plasmids. These plasmids help transfer this ready-made resistance to another organism. So gut ke andar hi wo ho jayega. Saath saath baitha hua E. coli picks up a plasmid, it transfers it to Klebsiella. So a Klebsiella which was sensitive earlier now would be resistant. And this plasmid has this unique capability of coding for resistance to multiple antibiotics at one go. So that is why you suddenly find MDRs coming up. Teesra hai, talking about the same thing, antibiotics are after all derived from fungi. So fungi also have been there since ages along with the bacteria. So the bacteria have already seen the antibiotics. So some amount of resistance may be there in the background in the environment. Example, penicillin was used in 1941. But uske pehle hi staphylococcal isolates resistant to penicillin was seen. Because penicillin is found from, or rather manufactured from penicillium notatum, which is a fungus, ubiquitous environmental fungus. So staph in the environment, penicillin in the environment, it has already picked up some resistance even before the antibiotic was used. This is the primary thing, excessive antibiotic use. I'll come to this in slightly more details. Lacks infection control practices in the hospital. So that means my hand is clean. Khana khane ke pehle hum haath dhote hain. So why not before touching the patient? Why not after touching the patient? Because each person has got his own set of unique organisms. We may feel ki clean hai, but clean nahi hai. Even if you clean your skin, there are some organisms which are still left. They are called the commensals. Pathogens nikal jayenge. But if you do not clean them, the pathogens will also be sitting there. That is what is important. Lastly, worldwide travel, which helps transfer of these organisms rapidly. Like that's what happened to NDM. Somebody contracted it in India, took it to United States, and there it was found that NDM was there in that isolate. So the next point about excessive antibiotic use, which I talk about, how much? There was an estimate which was made about 2-3 years back, in which it was found that we are producing about 22,000 tons of antibiotics every year. And out of this, 50% is dispensed to human beings. And the veterinary industry is not far behind, 40% is consumed by them. Mota taja chicken banana hai, mota taja mutton banana hai. Because by giving antibiotics, they are suppressing the flora and the animal becomes, you know, it starts absorbing more nutrition, becomes gets more muscle mass. So that is where the problem comes up. And this was the 2015 data in which we found the DDD per 1000 population as it is given, and the maximum use is found in Africa, some of the European countries, Egypt, and some India somewhere falls in between. So when we talk about consumption of antibiotics over the years, from 2000 to 2015, if you track, there is a gross increase in the consumption of cephalosporins as far as India is concerned. And fluoroquinolones are also not far behind, but somehow there has been a dip here. So probably people are becoming aware that yes, because of the resistance to fluoroquinolones, we should not be ending up using it so frequently. To compare, as far as livestock is concerned, you see India is in the red zone. That means we are contributing quite a bit to livestock use of antibiotics. And it is predicted that we will end up contributing another 18% more in the next 15 years or 20 years. So that control has to be there probably, and government is seized of this matter and we are taking steps to improve that. So WHO has defined how, again, misuse of antibiotic puts us all at risk. I'll just repeat it, the situations. Overprescription of antibiotics is the first one. Patients not finishing their treatment, that means at the OPD level, they don't complete their course. I'll come to this point slightly later because there is a change in thought process which has taken place. Overuse of antibiotics in livestock and fish farming, poor infection control in hospital and clinics, lack of hygiene and poor sanitation. Unfortunately, India is a tropical country, and generally our sense of hygiene in the community is a bit low, maybe because of lack of education, or maybe because of lack of money. And there is a major thing which I want to talk about, is lack of new antibiotics that are being developed as far as drug discovery is concerned. That is why we are coming to this problem. Now, when you see the drug discovery pipeline, we started using medication from about early 1900 onwards, which with salvarsan was the first antibiotic that was used, I think against syphilis, if I am not wrong. Slowly, we put in a lot of antibiotic groups by 1950-60. Those were the heydays for the antibiotic. There were a lot of antibiotics which were produced during this time frame. Slowly, it started petering out, and now from 1990 to 2010, there has been no new class of antibiotic that has come up. People are just recycling the older antibiotics, maybe tweaking one molecule here, tweaking one molecule there, adding some molecule, giving in a new product, and the pharmaceutical rep will come to you and say, this is the panacea for the next, let's say, all infections that come in. That is what is happening. But actually speaking, we are just recycling these antibiotics. It is interesting to know, colistin, which is the last resort antibiotic as on today, was being used earlier. It was not used because of its toxicity. Now that antibiotic has come back. It is not a new antibiotic. It is an existing antibiotic which has been brought back. So this has to be taken into account. And secondly, why this void once again is because there is not much of money in antibiotics as far as the pharmaceuticals are concerned, or for research people are concerned, because you require money for research. How long does it take for a drug to come into the market? Any idea? 12 to 13 years is the average. That is after it has undergone all the phase trials, come to the post-marketing phase, and then got accepted. It takes about 12 to 13 years. So somebody has to be there with a kind of venture capitalist who has to commit that much of money. And if he commits that much of money, he is not a philanthropist or something like that, that he Bill Gates kar raha hai. But everybody cannot be Bill Gates. Everybody doesn't have a fat back balance like that. He is expecting something in return. So if he expects something in return, then it is a profit motive. And the very purpose of developing that antibiotic goes for a six. So that is why people are concentrating more on lifestyle diseases rather than on antibiotics, because that is more profitable. So coming back to the prescribing for human beings, there is a 30% rule that operates. 30% of all hospitalized patients at any time receive antibiotics. 30% of antibiotics are prescribed inappropriately in the community. I think that is what we are here for, to kind of, you know, get the message across. Up to 30% of all surgical prophylaxis is inappropriate. And 30% of hospital pharmacy costs are due to antimicrobial use. And it also states that 10 to 30% of pharmacy costs can be saved by antimicrobial stewardship programs. So antimicrobial stewardship program is essentially meant for the hospital. But at the same time, in the community also, there has to be some kind of, you know, guide to the antibiotic therapy. So they also tried to find out what is the prescribing determinant for an antibiotic in a, let's say, OPD kind of situation or a clinic kind of situation, where they found the topmost criteria was lack of appropriate knowledge. Lack of appropriate knowledge, why? Because of maybe lack of CMEs or lack of further education opportunities. So the medical rep quietly steps into that void. He is the one who is now promoting it. The second one is inappropriate peer norms or poor modeling. That means what I have learned from my seniors, that continues. My experience of 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, that continues. Fear of clinical failure and desire to stay on the safe side. I think this psychology works with all clinicians as well as the patients. They want immediate results or maybe fast results. So automatically the next point is desire to meet patient demand. Patients demand antibiotics. In fact, there was a WHO survey carried out on idea of antibiotic in various countries. It was in India, they found that up to 75% people believed that the antibiotic which worked for my brother will work for me also, and I can always use the antibiotic which is left over at home. Third, any cold can be treated by antibiotic. So these three major points that they found were societal kind of pressures which promoted the use of antibiotic for everything. Marketing influences also were there. Probably this was conducted in a Western country, so we find much less, the bar is quite small here. But as far as India is concerned, marketing influence has got a large role to play. So just to summarize, what are the pressures and constraints faced by a clinician? At the top, he wants to prescribe the best medicine, disregarding the cost or spectrum of activity of the chosen antibiotics. Second was lack of access to diagnostics, especially near patient or point of care kind of diagnostics. But now with hospitals coming up, and especially in your area, we have such a good hospital here. This lab setup is excellent. So if you refer patients here, you can be guaranteed that you will get a good lab result, which you can depend upon. I would issue a note of warning here. There are small labs which keep coming up. They may be good for biochemistry, they may be good for hematology, because automated analyzers are there, no interpretation is required. But in the case of microbiology, culture results, please be careful, because the culture results, in spite of automation, require the interpretation by a microbiologist. It is not just ki machine ne report nikala, chhap diya, report nikal diya. And many small labs I have found, they do not give the minimum inhibitory concentration. I hope you people understand what is MIC. MIC is gives you an idea whether that drug will work or not. Just by writing R and S is of no consequence. The MIC has become important now. And all your automated machines are able to give the MIC. Wo pehle zamana tha jab disk diffusion karte the, usme MIC nahi milta tha. But ab MIC milta hai. And that MIC can be interpreted easily. The other part of the story, since you people are all attached to Bharati Hospital, we are available there. You can call up any time, discuss that report on the telephone or on WhatsApp. We will be able to give you the interpretation better. Then lack of standard treatment guidelines. Now, I will be coming to this in the latter part of the lecture, what Government of India is doing. So we do have some standard treatment guidelines coming up now. Marketing pressures of pharmaceuticals, as already mentioned. Failure of empirical therapy, that is a fear of failure. So sometimes the idea, psychology comes that newer the better or more the better. So you are looking for newer antibiotics, which probably is not required, and an older antibiotic may work. Last but not the least is the shorter patient consultation time. There is a busy practice, the patient is also in a hurry, doctor is also in a hurry, so antibiotic do aur kaam khatam karo, that kind of psychology comes up. So after all, what are we talking about? We are talking about infection control. I had started with that point. The middle pillar of infection control is prudent use of antibiotics. That is where it starts. Because by imprudent use, as I already mentioned, you are encouraging resistance to develop. Hand washing is one of the major pillars. Hand washing, hand se hi transfer hota hai, because that is what we use to examine the patient. And environmental decontamination is also important. Your clinic area, that cleaning has to be done at least 2 to 3 times in a day, because patients keep coming in and out. There are different organisms which can be found on the environment. So just to revise this, you must have been presented somewhere or the other. There are 5 movements of hand hygiene as far as the hospital is concerned. One is before touching a patient. Second is before clean or aseptic procedures being conducted on the patient. Third is after body fluid exposure, that means it could be a urinary catheter or a drain which has been put in. Fourth is after touching a patient, and fifth is after touching patient surroundings. So these are the 5 moments of hand hygiene which have been described by WHO. Second is, again I would like to insist, all of us should be bare below the elbows when we are dealing with the patients. One is bare below the elbows. Secondly, my fingers are absolutely blank. My wrist is absolutely blank. So I have prevented any nidus where I can accumulate organisms. No thread around the wrist. We are all clinical people. So at least when in touch with the patients, we can remove all this. That is what is important. That's what is shown there. So bangles, your watch, your rings, all these are going to collect organisms and probably transmit them to the patient. They may even be harmful for you if you are not careful. So that is one part of the story. Bare below the elbows is important. Now this is one thing. This is like a uniform for us. So there are 2 things wrong which I would like to point out as far as this picture is concerned. One is the stethoscope. How many times have you cleaned the stethoscope bell? Any time? after every patient also. So this is what I'm trying to insist, so that it gets cleaned at least twice, once before the patient, you touch the patient, and once after you touch the patient. Because what happens is, this alcohol which is there, it is not a permanent solution, it's a temporary solution, it reduces the load, but the organism can again multiply and, you know, develop on that surface. Heart may be very same principle applies. The second is your lab coat. Lab coat is for your protection, but if it is a full sleeve lab coat, or the lab coat is not washed at a regular interval, it's going to be nidus for picking up organisms. So these are two things which I wanted to point out here. Coming to the stewardship part, what we are following in the hospital, I just wanted to describe it so that you are aware how we operate the stewardship program in the hospital. So here we have somebody prescribing an antibiotic on admission when the patient gets admitted. There is a justification form to be filled up by the prescriber. At the moment, we are not insisting on this. So an ICN or a clinical pharmacist fills up this form for them. And they ensure that an appropriate culture sampling has been done before initiation of the antibiotic. Because if you have started the antibiotic, there is good chance that it may not grow in the culture as desired. So we will be fishing in the dark. Now, having done that, the prescription of that antimicrobial is audited for appropriateness as per hospital antibiotic policy within 48 to 72 hours. We have a running antibiotic policy which describes what antibiotic to be given empirically in case indicated, depending upon what is the clinical situation of the patient. This is audited by the clinical pharmacist, the microbiologist and the ID physician, whoever is available. We go around the hospital and audit it. In case there is a problem, we issue a stop order. We endorse on the case sheet that this antibiotic is not indicated, please stop. That please stop or de-escalate based on antimicrobial policy or culture results is to be implemented by the so-called antimicrobial champion. We have nominated antimicrobial champions per department or per ward. He is the gentleman who is supposed to implement that. And now with WhatsApp available, it is very easy to load a message on the group, and the person sees the message immediately and takes action by that day itself to ensure that the antibiotic is stopped or de-escalated. This is further followed up by the clinical pharmacist that actually has it been stopped in the treatment chart or not. At the end of the day, or maybe at the end of the month, we then calculate the consumption of the antibiotic based on duration of therapy. That means if an antibiotic has been given for 7 days, we take it as 7 DOTs for that antibiotic. And we add on for so many patients that may have been given that antibiotic. So somebody was given 10 days, somebody was given 7 days, somebody was given 5 days. So you accumulate all this, you divide it by the patient volume for that month, that means the patient days for that month, and multiply it by 1000 to give you a standard figure. So that gives us the consumption across the hospital. So it can compare between wards, it can compare between specialties, it can compare between beds also. So that's a nice system of how to go about checking the consumption of the antibiotic. So we talked about the psychology of consumption of antibiotics, and our Prime Minister also got into it in the Mann Ki Baat in July 2016. He had talked about this, ki we need required to control the use of antibiotics, and he had kind of exhorted the people to think and talk about it. He says, koi bhi bimari aa jaye, koi bhi fever aa jaye, antibiotic khane ke liye taiyar ho jate ho, but socho ki antibiotic zarurat hai ki nahi, kisi ke advice ke bina antibiotic nahi lena hai. So that is how he started the whole process, and with that we came on to something called the National Plan for Combating Antimicrobial Resistance. So this was more or less a WHO guided plan, and India woke up to it. India was one of the third world countries which had no action plan till about 2011 or 12, and then subsequently it found fruition in 2016-17, and now we have a action plan. So in this action plan, what we have done right now, first is we have established laboratory based surveillance system of about 30 network of labs all over India. So that means even Bharati Hospital is participating in transmitting resistance information on all the organisms that we isolate over the year to this network. So that network then transmits the data centrally to WHO. They have a global antimicrobial surveillance system. So we know that in India, what is the general resistance patterns that are seen in the hospital. We have published national infection control guidelines, which majorly target the hospitals. We have published treatment guidelines, which promote the rational use of antibiotics, and also conducting awareness campaigns about rational use of antibiotics. So here is where you people as the GPs in the community can probably get it across. It will not be an easy job. Patient will demand antibiotics, but then it's time to get a change. It's time to tell them that antibiotic is not the solution to all your problems. So the National Infection Control Guidelines have been published. They are available on the ICMR website. Anytime you access the website, all these guidelines are there. The second one, of the latest one which has come, is the treatment guidelines for antimicrobial use in common syndromes. So this is really nice. So in the OPD setting also, it is able to tell us what kind of antibiotics we should be using. This is also available on the ICMR website. These are some suggestions which possibly some kind of posters you can make and put it on your own clinic walls, just to get across the idea that bacche ko jab se sardi zukam ho to kya karna hai, kya nahi karna hai, you know, gharelu ilaj is what is we are looking at, what can be achieved. For diarrhea also, again, gharelu ilaj is more important rather than giving antibiotic. So here Chacha Chaudhary and Sabu, one of the comic characters, is trying to say, bhaiya cold ho gaya to usme antibiotic kaam nahi karega, cold ke liye rest lene ka hai, because that's the commonest thing we say, sardi zukam ho gaya, antibiotic khao. Right. So these are the kind of ads that we should be taking out. Cold or flu, take care, not antibiotics. And recently we have had some NGOs also launching awareness campaigns, which have been coming out. And I think in the TV also some ads have come out using the celebrities, where they have recommended not using antibiotics for every situation. So what can doctors do? I'm coming to the bottom line now. What we can do? One is infection control and prevention process, that is as far as the hospital is concerned. So in the clinics also, if we can apply this kind of situation, it will be really nice. Using diagnostics to make an informed decision. Again, I agree, it will be better in the hospital, but in the OPD setting also, you should be able to make a kind of situation where, or a clinical judgment, where an investigation, a bare minimum investigation, will help you further diagnose whether it is a viral infection or a bacterial infection. Viral infection, the blood count is not going to rise, the neutrophils are not going to rise. So that kind of interpretation you should be able to make. Prescribe and dispense antibiotics only when they are needed according to current guidelines. So we already have a treatment guidelines. If you can go through the guidelines, there will be a change in the prescription pattern. Now this is the important part, what you can do. Do you talk to patients about how to take antibiotics correctly? Antibiotic resistance and dangers of misuse. So once you start kind of educating them, I am not saying that all of them will understand immediately, but then there's a process has to be started. And most important is talk to the patient about preventing infections. I think Pune was a hotbed of H1N1 infection in 2009-10. That is where H1N1 came to India. So a simple solution could have been followed by like the Japanese wear masks. So if these patients had worn masks, it would have sorted out a lot of issues. Fomites, sneezing and coughing into the crook of your elbow. What do we normally do? We put a hand like this, but yehi haath aur kahin lagega, koi aur usko pakad karke jayega. So always advise your patients to sneeze or cough into the crook of the elbow. Ye kahin aur koi chhuega nahi. Right? Even if they use a hanky, that hanky is going to lie somewhere. So this was something which I had just picked up as a, you know, sideline. So kehta hai tumhare paas kya hai, so what we generally tend to say, instead of mere paas maa hai, we say mere paas antibiotic hai. You see, that is the concept right now. Antibiotic kisi se puchne ki zarurat nahi. Antibiotic is maine isko dawa de diya hai abhi dua kaam karega, that kind of thing. Chalo, anyway, so should we use antibiotic as an umbrella? Be judicious. If you keep using it as an umbrella, we'll end up in this kind of situation where they will create an umbrella for themselves. They're already creating an umbrella for themselves. They're evolving and the antibiotics are becoming useless. So let us be our antibiotic guardians. The bottom line is, what kind of world are we going to leave for our children? because WHO has already predicted that by 2050, about 40 to 60% of the deaths will be occurring because of multi-resistant organisms if we continue at the same rate. So, hamari to zindagi nikal jayegi, but hamare bachcho ke liye hum kya chhod ke ja rahe hain? That is what is important. So, I think we can all take a pledge today. Protect the antibiotics, protect the limited resource that is available to us. Let that be given to the patient who actually requires it and not as a psychological support.